to your commission.
Thank you, Mayor Northwoods. That's, he does that every time.
Always going somewhere.
He's punching out the moment we start our meeting.
Or something.
All right, so outside of our topic of discussion about volunteer organization, do our visitors have any public comment? All right, in that case, we're going to move on to approval of the previous meeting's minutes. I just noticed one thing that I wanted to amend. And that is, the way we adjourned is not the way I remember it. I don't actually remember a motion to adjourn made by Andrew and seconded by Jen. What I remember is that we had a motion on the table by Rob to extend the meeting. It was seconded by Jen. We voted on it. It was never seconded.
It was never seconded, so that's why I don't have it.
No, it was dead. It was definitely seconded, but because then we had a vote.
No, never voted on it, never seconded.
We voted, and we voted, Rob voted to, Todd and I voted not to, and the rest of the people abstained.
That's correct.
Yet to extend.
That was to extend.
I just rewatched it.
Oh, you rewatched it?
Yeah, and that's why I made the effort with Deb to just leave it out. I made the decision to leave it out because evidently it didn't pick up somebody seconding it.
Oh, yeah. Do you remember, I'll just ask the other people in the room, because in the absence of clear video data, I feel like we should just confer. So I remember that Rob made the motion. He asked Jay to second, and Jay said, I'll do it, but I, you know, he sort of did it a little bit unwillingly, but he did it. He seconded the motion, and then we had a vote, and Rob raised his hand in favor, Todd and I voted no, and the rest of the people in the room abstained, and so I said, we're not going to extend the meeting, and then the meeting was adjourned.
Correct.
You're nodding, you remember.
I'm not reliable source. In that department.
I would say like 90% sure that's what happened.
Okay, so then, I just want to reflect that this is not how the meeting ended.
Okay, and I can add that in there.
Okay.
I'm going to watch it.
You're going to watch this again?
Yes.
So, yes, there's a motion to extend the meeting.
Okay.
Seconded by Jay, and then in favor one, against two, rest were abstentions, so against five. All right. Any other amendments to the minutes?
I guess I have a question. When it says solar, does that mean we discussed solar or something, or other business not reasonably anticipated solar?
You know, what she probably did is she took the, I had said that I was going to,
I don't have a memory or an issue here. I'm just wondering what it means something.
I'd have to go back to the other agenda, see if I put it on as a bullet, but I wouldn't have because if it was other business, I wouldn't have done it. But I think early on in the meeting, I had said we were going to pick up the topic of the letter to the editor regarding solar panels. And I had intended to, but then we got a little bit sidetracked with the discussion of volunteer organization. So we actually did not take that up.
Okay.
And so I think that could be excised, actually.
Okay.
Chair report. and this was something I had hoped you would kind of clarify a little bit before we broke on the last meeting, if we get a chance to. But in a future conversation I had with Todd after the meeting, when he had offered to draft a letter, what he really wanted to make clear, what he made clear to me by email, and now wanted to make clear to you, was that he wanted to do that in his capacity as ED of the Hampshire Council of Governments, and not in his capacity as a member of the Tree Commission. I am comfortable with that, but I certainly wanted to make sure that you all are. He's drafted a letter, and it's, you know, it's not something that, in my opinion, we need to comment on, because it's not coming from us. So I just wanted to make sure that you all know that, and, you know, if you have any objection to that, this would be the time.
What was the letter on the Guardian?
It was on the record.
Yeah, it was just supporting, kind of building off of Lappin's letter that he wrote as chair of the Amherst Public Shade Tree Commission, where he just talked about shade trees versus putting solar on your roof.
Yeah.
He mentioned two alternatives to that. I'm gonna make it a Northampton-centric version of it, and mention another alternative, which happens to be something that's through the Hampshire Council. But it's not a letter generated by or mentioned of the, you know, Public Shade Tree Commission, since we're different and everything operates.
Okay, any thoughts or comments on that one? Okay. And this is very brief. I just got back from San Francisco, and I just wanted to share the observation that, you know, a pretty forward-thinking, progressive, very tree-minded city. I mean, if you look at their tree management plan and so forth, their broader, smart growth, what do they call it, street?
Smart streets.
Smart streets plan. Trees feature very, very prominently. And so it came as somewhat of a surprise to me that I saw so many streets that were monoculture, that were exclusively one type of tree on a particular street. And I just wanted to say two things about that, to broaden our, I think we have this perception, we sort of embrace this philosophy that all maximum diversity is the way to go with planting trees. And so I just wanted to throw out this paradigm challenge. And one is that the streets are beautiful and easy to manage, because all the trees were planted roughly at the same time, grow to roughly the same size, and provide a sort of canopy that you can't get from a diverse planting, especially at different sizes. So that's the first one, is the aesthetics, beauty, and the management is really quite astounding. And then the second is, I just want to throw out, there is an expert in walkable cities, his name is Jeff Speck. He published a book called Walkable Cities. It's pretty known nationally. And he kind of argues in favor of that type of planting, and he doesn't argue that we choose a monoculture throughout the whole city, but he does argue that whole streets that have the same kind of tree are so aesthetically beautiful that they have their own, you know, they have their own character, I think that they provide more value. And then what he says is they can be a little bit of a bellwether. If you do have a disease that comes through, it's going to hit one street. It's not going to necessarily hit the whole city, but you'll really know that disease is coming through because it's going to hit a street. So I just want to throw that out as a possible paradigm shifting, or at least a consideration of a different approach. I feel like we have really embraced this maximum diversity on any given street. And aesthetically, it doesn't move me the way the streets were moving me.
I want to mention the webinar from UMass about the 5% per genus. You mentioned this. It was in there about having rows of any one particular tree, not being a problem.
Not being what?
A problem.
Yeah.
It's in that. What you're just proposing is in the webinar.
Oh, really?
I can't remember who did it.
Jamba.
Yes, that's right. Yes. So what he's proposing is you can get to 5% any one family or whole. Not genus, yeah, genus. 5% per genus. But it's okay to have masses of individual trees. Because he presents it as an economic problem, not an ecological problem. That is, that having a bunch of the same trees near each other doesn't, in itself, create a problem. It's that if you lose them, you have to be able to afford to replace them.
Yeah.
So that's a reason not to have a monoculture through the whole city.
Yeah. So anyway, that, I just wanted to share that observation.
And I'm wondering, as we do our plantings, if we could even extend a little bit on that, if maybe not plant multiple trees in one area, but maybe at least a couple, so that, that are comparable. So you might have the same sort of shape or height.
Right, so Cornell.
Aesthetically, it's similar, but you have these little trees in a couple of species.
Cornell, I think you probably read the Cornell recommendation on tree, like in their urban tree program, they have a, they give a graphic of different tree shapes and then try to help you line up different species or similar. And so that, that's how they approach having multiple species look like a row.
Right.
And I think that's what you're.
Okay, I'm going to take one more comment on this subject and then we're going to move on to it. It's never meant to be like a.
Could we place on a future agenda to look at interim public shade tree planting guidelines to inform our fall and spring planting?
Yeah, what was the first word you used?
Interim.
Interim, yes. Oh. Okay.
Lengths of time, and we were under the impression that it just automatically re-upped, but it doesn't, so they just have to fill out a form.
It's been a year.
Yeah, their term expired June of 2016. So,
there we go.
All right, so now we have one, two, I'm assuming four.
You go for a run, man. Change the.
Okay.
No, actually, what we're going to, what you'll end up doing is you'll, we will just.
Why don't we postpone voting on the minutes that we just voted on?
What you're going to have to do in reality is you're going to have to wipe out the first step. The first step didn't exist, so it's going forward. Now, it starts the public shade tree commission.
First.
Correct. And if you want to not start from the beginning, but at least approve the minutes with the people that are here that are.
I think I'm going to postpone until next week so that these two can be back in.
Did we ever turn on the?
Yeah,
okay, so I'm restarting the meeting of the Public Shade Tree Commission. It's 4:15, and our quorum consists of Andrew Smith, Rob Postle, Jan Warner, and Lillian Lombardi, while Todd and Marilyn get re-upped on their terms. All right, so what we're going to do then is we're going to postpone the minutes that we thought we just approved from July, and we're going to, we'll approve those next month. Okay, so we haven't really done that. Other than that, we haven't done any real business at all.
No, just opening the meeting and
All right. Okay, tree board report.
So just a couple items. The bid opening for the shade tree inventory is next Thursday at 11 a.m. And so far, the vendors that have taken out the actual bid documents are Dating Tree, Arbor Pro, Time Bond, Prime Vendor, which is just an online group that takes every bid. I don't even know what they do with it, and they return them.
They're clearing us.
Fitzgerald, yes, Fitzgerald, Galladay, Hartford, I've never heard of them, I don't know that. Amoeba, Save the Tree, Park Corporation, and Greensill Environment. So they're all in possession of our bid document, however they decide to do it. We open them at 11, and we'll end up actually going over the bid document and reviewing it. It is pretty technical.
Do you feel like you're still on schedule?
I think so. I mean, our contract that was just signed is due today. We're 3-3 up, as we were told, it's going to the end of December 31st. And if we have to, it's not done for some reason, we can ask for an extension, which has been done in the past as well.
Can I ask a question about the inventory, our specs?
I'm going to just a quick question. Okay, just as long as it's
just put it
a tree board report.
Okay. Well, when I was making calls for volunteer management, they talked with the tree warden in Belmont and just mentioned that we're doing inventory. He said that some companies teach how to identify, measure, and check for structural integrity as well as perform the inventory. And I was just wondering if that was part of ours or if we even feel we need to.
It says teach.
In addition to doing it themselves, identifying and giving us the quantifiable evidence, some companies will also teach, I guess, staff and or volunteers, if deemed necessary, how to...
There is a component that will be oversight from myself and Jay, and I think there is no teaching component for this, because we actually want a professional, mm-hmm. We want a professional, quite a professional, so there is not a component. However, once we have gathered all this data, qualifications of folks that actually are going to be doing the inventory, I have qualifications. 22nd has the qualifications, and Jay has the qualifications. So if we want to do an inventory ourselves, I think we could probably be teaching other folks to do basic things, but the tree risk assessment aspect, we have to have a certain. And I sent out with that bid sheet, I also sent out that bid document, I sent out a reference form. So every person who's actually going to be involved in that, whatever vendor we pick, has to give me their resume. And they also, if the vendor decides to change in the middle of the contract, what folks are actually using as new inventory, they can't change it without my approval. And I'll have to get the resumes for the new people that are actually doing it. Some people apparently have been where they've actually had. No, there's one arborist and they have all the other folks who are in, right? We're not arborists doing this tree risk certification, which, you know, another inventory items, which is not good. So, a couple stopgap measures and stuff I compiled from. A lot of stuff Molly sent me. So, we have a public shade tree hearing for 3 trees on Ryan Road on the 29th of August at 6 p.m. They're healthy public shade trees that have been approved for a national. Wiring project but it's at the end of Ryan Road by the Woods Valley. Don't
move. And this is request by National Grid?
Yes.
In your opinion, is it a reasonable request?
Yes. They're basically changing over the utility wires to fixed cable. The problem is that there's three trees right away of the fixed cable that's been also.
Are they significant trees?
There's a pine tree, it's a white pine that's pretty significant in size.
Are they actual public shade trees, or are they more like volunteer trees?
They're, that area probably volunteer trees.
Right.
And then, of course, we're just, you know, regular operations, we're just, all we're doing is watering. Every day, water, water, water.
Okay, on that note, Rich.
Yes, sir.
I noticed that some of the bags, I run into this problem too. Some of the bags aren't draining, so the guys have to, it's a very common problem, but they have to really shake them and make sure that the little tab is folded over. It's a very easy mistake. Because there's a couple of them that just drive past every day.
Like full, like a day on end.
I went out and fixed one.
It's easy, and it's a mistake that happens all the time, and it's not like anybody's doing a bad job, it's just a thing to.
Well, I'll remind them, thank you.
That's it for tree report?
Yeah, other than we're just, you know, we've done a lot of removals, we're actually caught up with all of our removals, all the high priority removals, so we're gonna start granting stumps. All the removals we've done this year, so here are all the stumps, make way for new trees.
I saw that that dead tree was removed, that we planted on Arbor Day at Bridge Street.
Yeah, we've got a few other trees we planted that are dead, that I'm gonna go back to, but I think else. I have not followed with shingles yet, but the air plant as well.
You know, the only thing I was thinking about with shingles in the future, because the problem we had with them was obvious and immediate, I'm just worried that with this whole period of drought, they may somehow associate the death of the trees with lack of care because there's been a drought period. So just putting it out there that I think that if we have a problem with the vendor in the future, we should just let them know right away. So that there's no question that the beef that we have with them is related to the stock and not anything that we've done with this stock. Hopefully that will work. Did you get something from the mayor's office?
Yes, so because you're an advisory board to the mayor, she, Lynn, feels that you can still continue to vote.
We need what?
It's like being in the situation.
I amend the amendment that I just amended.
It was being passed.
A ship at sea.
Okay. All right, so then I think that if that's the case, then I think that the minutes that we have amended are approved.
One of the things that we do in my watering is we have a list we go by, and it's all dated. So it actually shows what trees we water, what location, what date we water. So if there's any questions from any of the vendors, they're personally plans for us to answer them.
Okay.
You know, we've added trees to the list as well from about before. So our list is huge. It's not just trees we planted this year, it's trees we planted for the last 3 or 4 years that have really been suffering. Some of the larger ones died.
Yeah. Molly, do you have some broader perspective on this phenomenon?
Trees dying and purchasing?
Yeah. Well, both that, because we had a really, really high mortality rate for the trees we got from shingles. And I don't want to talk too much about it, but we have 5 minutes. And basically, the moment they came off the truck, the roots were dehydrated. So that's that one. And then the other is just this summer, anything community's been doing that we haven't thought of to keep the trees alive.
I was thinking about your question about volunteers watering. And I was at a meeting a couple weeks ago where they hold like a very brief event to train people, and it gets publicized. Try to bring people in, maybe a doctor to train. I have more notes on it that I can send you. But that was just one other option. And the bare root, if the roots dry out, it can be tough. So depending how they came.
roots were broken. They were actually broken.
Like the structural roots?
Structural roots, yeah, broken, meaning, so.
I have not seen that.
Yeah, so, I mean, Jay recommended that we remove every single broken structural root, which we did.
Yeah.
But I have a photograph of like a tree with a pile of root, so I'm assuming that Rachel sent that along.
Yeah, I mean, it could be, you know, they have broken roots and root loss plus drying plus drought.
And is it reasonable for vendors to stand by when their product is that subpar? I mean, it sounds like it was either the vendor themselves or the transport company that screwed up because they appeared damaged and, or, you know, the gel was, like, there was barely enough gel on it.
Yeah. I don't know how easy it is to get a company to stand by that. I mean, a lot of times treats are guaranteed for a year. Sometimes communities will waive that for price or other considerations. But if they were damaged, it should be something that's noted at the time. I mean, the advice is to not accept the delivery, but that's hard when you have a volunteer. You know, have volunteers that need planting.
Yeah, so we do, we go through the list and we say, we also like to go see what we're buying before we go there. It's the benefit of working with somebody close by is you get to see what you're getting. Before you get on a truck, you have to send it back, so.
Right. I'm going to move this on to the next subject. Okay, so we are going to have a discussion with the guests in the room, along with the rest of us, about how we can best leverage volunteer energy and skills to advance our tree program and what the organizational structure of that might look like. So thank you all for coming. I'd love for you all to introduce yourselves. Do we have four? And then no one else?
We have four. One probably can't come. She has small children and she had some unexpected.
That's Alicia?
Alicia, correct. Yes.
Kirby. All right. So would you all like to introduce yourselves and then we can continue around the room and actually you can, you know, connect someone with a skill set because everyone in this room has their own skill set as well.
All right. I'll introduce myself. My name is Sue Balkhaus. I've lived here in Northampton for over 20 years. And I provided some biographical information. My strengths in coming to this project, certainly a passion for trees and lifelong passion for trees and volunteer service. And I have been a professional volunteer manager, coordinator in various capacities at some of the institutions around the valley and organized volunteers in both Camden and Hampshire counties. And I came to awareness that there were volunteers involved with tree planting in Northampton, but that maybe I could lend some of my skills and experience to helping pull together the technical resources in terms of tree knowledge and also using the internet and the web and tools available to streamline and organize a way for people to become involved, engaged in trees, and to build more of a culture of trees in the city, an appreciation for trees in the city, for planting, watering, pruning, tree planting care, and advocacy for trees. And there is the technical ladder. That's what I feel passionate about lending to the city, to the community capacity, and then three others who are also interested in helping.
Great.
Thank you very much for having us.
Sure.
I'm Susan Roy. I sort of introduced myself earlier in the summer, and so I just put a little brief blurb on there of my background from the university. And I've been a grower and a horticultural person all my life, and just having fun being one of Rob's groupies. We've spent the summer trying to get our structure going, and we're about to start trying to set some tables up to recruit people to do setback trees with Rob. And it's been a lot of fun. And I think we've made some good progress. Have you referred them to base camp at all yet?
No, there's been a lot of progress on the organizing on the web, and I've got something called base camps, so we communicate with each other, and Susan and Jonathan have done quite a bit of artwork in terms of finding things to put on the web. So a lot has been going on, but it takes quite a lot to launch this. So, you know, we've had your first meeting only about 2 months ago.
I'm Jonathan Gachi. How do you do? With these women, I've been able to look at the issue of the tree canopy in Northampton. Looking forward to getting involved with that. I grew up on a tree farm. My grandfather had about 18,000 acres in total in Hamp County. It was a big watershed that funded his company, the DJC company. And so as a kid, I got to ride around my uncle and watch where the forester was. By the time I could reach the levels of the gene, it was around 5. So I got to do a lot of that work. My wife and I retired 9 years ago, and we've done volunteer conservation service work. So I've been really lucky to work with the state of California, Texas, Florida, as well as U.S. Fish and Wildlife. In the RV camper program, volunteer program, we've also spent 2 years in Mississippi working with the Land Trust with Mississippi Coastal Plain, working with AmeriCorps and some other groups. The CPs was a big one for restoration projects designed for clearing out brush and building suitable habitat for both migratory birds and turtles. And in that work, that volunteer work, which is about 6 months each year, gained quite a bit of understanding about how volunteer groups work. We basically developed in Mississippi a alternative spring break program where we bring in several colleges with their students for spring break work. I don't know if that worked here in New England, unless they're from Canada or someplace, which is possible because that's where we have in Mississippi. But I think the citizens of Northampton step up enough to help tree warden, Northampton Public Shade Tree Commission, and I'd like to be a part of that in any way I can help with my understanding and experience. So we're working together. And our web designer isn't here right now, Alicia, because she's got a wrangly dog and a couple of toddlers, but she's always there.
I'll jump in. Alicia is an energetic young woman. She's been living in the city for a few years now, cares passionately about the environment and about the future for her children and the city. And she's brought primarily she's our lead tech person. She did set up a WordPress site. We were jointly on coming up with wording and design for that site. It's a simple site, but the idea being to have a web presence and use web tools for people to sign up and to manage volunteers and to provide clear, focused information for people in the city to describe a volunteer group and volunteer opportunities and to get people involved and informed and provide resources for people to learn more about the city's trees and trees in general and care for them. So Alicia, lots of energy and lots of technical skills, and she's an artist, to bring that aesthetic element to this.
Good.
And thank you very much.
Great. All right, let's just take, if you can reduce it to one or two sentences about you, and then we'll just quickly go around, just so you guys can be oriented to all the players around the table. And then we'll circle back to the discussion of, sounds like you guys are already really in the stages of forming your organization and clarifying what your mission and what your goals are. And So then it's a question of how we do this, you know, how we collaborate, whether there's perfect overlap or whether we just overlap in some way. So we'll get to that, but we'll start with you, Molly.
I'm Molly Freilicher. I work for the DCR Urban and Community Forestry Program, based in Amherst, and I'm visiting here today. I do periodically. And my job is to work with community groups, tree boards, new groups, in central and western Mass to help them increase their capacity for managing and advocating for shade trees.
I'm Andrew Smith. I work in the city of Holyoke. I'm the Conservation and Sustainability Director in the city of Holyoke. Part of my portfolio is urban forestry that I'm working close with DCR on. And I've been very fortunate to get a lot of support from DCR and a lot of support from our local nonprofit, which is Noho, which has allowed us to apply for grants for youth employment that we couldn't do without having a nonprofit as a partner. So I, for one, am really happy that you're here, and I'm glad that there's a nonprofit that's kind of stepping up to do some of the things that we can't do as a municipal entity, because every single tree program I've studied around the country has a strong nonprofit component in order to be successful. So I really hope that's something useful.
You've already met me. I'm Rob Winslow.
Yes,
and you know me. Along with Jen, we have been running the volunteer effort for Northampton, which has been pretty successful. We have a lot of people, but we are disorganized. And, you know, I partly went to ask you to get us better organized. And I feel like already we are better organized than we were. So thanks.
Hi, I'm Todd Ford. I'm Executive Director of the Hampshire Council of Governments. And I'm an urban planner by trade, and I grew up not on 18,000 acres, but on a 30-acre nursery. So it's been around the trees and plants.
I'm Jen Werner. I'm one of the meetings. I currently teach at Springfield Technical Community College in the Landscape Design and Management Program, and I'm a professional horticulturist. I went to school with that. I've been working in the industry for 30 years or something.
Hello, my name is Marilyn Castellano. Recently finished a master's degree in conservation biology, focused on climate change. And in addition to having practical experience in land conservation stewardship, I also have a diversity of skills in program development and event management and public outreach and education and public speaking. So, sort of a jack of all trades.
I'm a jack of all trades. So my name is Bruce Parasletti. I'm the highway superintendent and the tree warden. I work for the Department of Public Works in my 27th year. I'm certified, ISA certified arborist. I'm planting trees and doing tree work in the city. You guys just came out here. And so it's the right person at the right time to take this position. Nice thing about my position, I'm fortunate in the fact that actually I'm also responsible for the actual tree crew in the highway division, so I have a lot of, I should say, leverage in a sense to get a lot of these accomplishments, which has been very beneficial, I think. So I'm looking forward to working with your organization. Thank you.
I'm Terry Usho, and I work with Fridge.
Thank you. And I'm Lily Lombard. I've introduced myself to you all by email. And I, long-time volunteer and community organizer, currently a homeschool mom. That's a little bit about me. All right. Well, I don't know about the rest of you folks, but I would be interested in hearing from your group, since it seems like you're further along in formation than I had envisioned, which is great. I'm curious, because I always love to start way out and then come in. So I'm curious to know what you see as your mission, and whether that is, you know, as narrow as supporting the effort of this city of Northampton to advance our public shade tree program, or whether it's broader than that, because I hear a lot of, you know, naturalist, entomology, I know you have an, it's plant and soil science background. So whether it actually includes urban forestry that goes beyond the narrows of what our, you know, what our purview is. And so that would help me understand what some of your work objectives are.
Well, you know, the primary goal right now is to help Rob get his setback trees planted by the end of the planting season. And so one of my jobs at the moment is to contact places where we can put up a table. I'm probably gonna go on Vista Print and get Rob some little cards to hand out. And we're sort of trying to come up with some literature and, you know, references to our website, which Alicia's been working on and you've been working on, so that the presence is coherent. And it all feeds into this first job. I think we'll reassess once we get the trees done and see where else we need to fill in holes. I don't think we've formed any further than that. You want to add to that?
No, the immediate goal is to try to put together, in the short term, the structure and mechanisms for people to aid in getting the trees that need to be planted this planting season. We have lists of other great ideas and resources we'd like to provide and things we'd like to do and training and education. But immediately, as we've looked at, we first started, I reached out to the Amherst Ants. It's the little informal community group that assists the commission in Amherst. And then looked at all across the country, KC Trees and different groups to see how your organizational structure was and what kinds of events they had in volunteer opportunities. So focused on the volunteer opportunities in the very short term. We do have many other ideas for how Northampton could be served that way. And so it is in service to getting the job of volunteers helping out.
Cherry trees,
yes, the canopy.
Okay, great.
Absolutely. I'm so glad you mentioned Casey Trees, because that's what I think would be a prime example of a nonprofit that works really well to support the public shade tree canopy. So I think that's a good example from our nation's capital that has a good model that it would be nice if we can emulate that.
They are big.
They're enormous.
Yeah. Which
they're going to be like $100 million
diamonds. Which gets to the other point, which is that nonprofits can do fundraising from different funding sources than the municipality, which I think is a strong asset to the city. Nicole.
And as I was investigating other tree commissions or committees in our state of Massachusetts, just to see how they're working with volunteers. What I uncovered, which may not be the whole story, but at least the folks who I can get through to, interestingly, felt, and this was just three, it was Lexington, Belmont, and Cambridge, either there wasn't a need for volunteers or volunteers were sort of self-organizing and there wasn't a mechanism for coordination. And there were some suggestions for perhaps what volunteers could do, might be like street or neighborhood stewards. But so I just wanted to say that I think we have a rich opportunity here and that we have a new and robust commission. We've already achieved a lot in our first year, coming to our second. And secondly, we have so many residents who are interested, capable, ready to go. So perhaps we can create a new model, and maybe eventually people will be calling us, oh, how are you doing this? So I just want to say that I think there's a great field of potential here to get a lot of work done, and I would say preferably in coordination, somehow, whatever that mechanism is. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
From my understanding, there's various models of getting people, municipalities or groups going about tree plans, especially governmental groups, is having complete control, spending big budgets, and just taking care of every tree with a tree budget, or a kind of adopted tree, which gives up a lot of control. or a community-based model, which was, I think is most appealing, where the city has a plan and is buying the trees and has a tree plant, but building community capacity, because that builds awareness and people feel part of it. And so that's how I see the rules and the tree warden has the control over what trees where, and the commission makes decisions regarding that, and that this group would be advocacy, education, and volunteers.
Yeah, we go out and find the bodies.
Yeah, the bodies, and not be involved in the...
Yeah, we don't want to get in Rich's way.
Yeah. Someone has a question.
He's smiling.
Talk to the tree commission about that. We're volunteer, we're getting it done.
And that's how you're self-selecting. That's what you guys want to do.
Yeah, we welcome feedback on the areas you'd like us to focus on. If you have things that you'd like to hand off, I think we can probably, I think we have the capability to figure out how to solve a problem, but we need to know what problems you'd like to give us to work on.
So we build capacity.
Once we get done with getting Rob's trees planted.
So that's, I mean, it's only because it's a short-term problem that you have had to focus on this, because that's what I've brought to you.
Yeah, but it's also a great learning experience.
Right, and it helps shape the organization. Okay, we have something to deal with that's concrete, and the trees do need to be planted in October, so it's...
Maybe. It's better than the weather.
Yeah, the weather has not been...
Billy? We realize that weather is not really conducive to the type of thing we want to do. And when Rob brought to us the fact that the spring planting numbers still haven't hit the limit of trees that we want to have in or are close to it, and summer plantings have been called off because of the climate conditions, we looked at that as, well, there must be trees that need to be planted, and so that is the main focus. Developing the organization as a nonprofit or the form that we take ultimately, I think still is something that we're looking at in developing. The first thing we want to do is have tools to reach volunteers in our community and to help mitigate or reduce the crisis that the trees have. And to that end, we've done a couple of things. One of the things that we did was look at, could we help in watering? And so we put together a little watering unit as a prototype or a pilot to see if that could work. And it looks like it could work. We don't have the right equipment right now, but it would be a simple fix to do that. So that's something we can go ahead with to help. When I hear the city's tree warden talk about his staff watering trees, I think that's a great downtime day. But really the important stuff the tree committee does is really based on safety. I look at the tree commission work with the tree warden and the city's arborist as making the community safe with its trees. Because the trees in the tree belts are highly stressed plants, structures that the city needs and also needs to have safe. And so if there's some small pieces that we can do to help take the strain off of the city, it's public services and as well as this commission, that'd be great, and that's something we're looking to do. At this point, we're really in this formation where we're the nucleus, and the three of us are here right now. Mm-hmm. So right now you've got 100% of the committee here. When the fourth one shows, it'll be 120. we're giving it a shot.
I was just wondering if you are already working with lists that we were able to generate through the public survey last fall, because I do have that list and it's been shared with the committee, and just so that anybody who did express interest is in the fold.
Well, Marilyn, it's not my knowledge that we're using those lists, but I do recall getting an email from you that was requesting or sounding out volunteers in the community, which I filled out.
Yes.
And then came to an Arbor Day event. And then got rolled into this. And I don't know how that list evolved or where it exists,
but we don't have
that would be a great thing for us to be able to use to provide volunteers an opportunity or at least a place to develop.
Because one of the 10 questions on this public survey last fall was interest in volunteering, and there was a number of ways that people could express the interest, and one was with Arbor Day. So when Arbor Day was approaching, I just sent out an email to those interested in the Arbor Day. But we could provide a full list. And I guess in terms of mechanisms, just wondering what the best way to coordinate this. Maybe one of us on the commission, perhaps me or somebody else, Rob or Jim, could send an email to all those who are interested and say, as a member of the commission, we now have this subset of volunteers who are stepping up as volunteer leaders. So they'll be in touch with you, but at least it could be coming from us to maybe be a little bit more official. I don't know.
I think that's a very good idea, you know, because of the trust they put in the commission, sharing their information to have an introduction.
Okay.
Well, I mean, to me, it seems like that is still a city list that they're helping us organize. To me, I don't see it as we're giving it to this nonprofit organization, and then it's theirs to do what they will with. To me, it's like they're supporting a city effort, and they're doing it by us handing off to them a piece of our work, which is the volunteer coordination.
Yes.
That's the way. That's
volunteers.
I think.
Or is it subcontracting?
Excuse me.
Or is it subcontracting? Where you're taking the volunteers?
Yeah, some expectation that this is not going to be shared further, and that really you're working for the city in this capacity.
But there's nothing stopping them from creating their own lists.
No.
No. That would be our
everything here forward is anybody's.
I have a sort of in between. Solution to this is so that no one is actually contacted by this organization that doesn't want to be. And that is, if the commission could take the list and just send it to the people who wanted volunteer and say, look, there is a volunteer opportunity if you want to go to their website or send them an email. And that way, people can choose to be involved or not be involved in it, and then it's not a city entity once people take that action of going, okay, I'm interested. Because they've written in, I mean, I think some people, including Jonathan, sort of expressed that, and actually other people, that they signed up, they said they were interested, and then nothing happened. I've heard that a few times. And so this would be, that is, we can follow up on it. Not that we're obligated to, but people kind of signed up and said, yeah, I'd give money, I'd give time, and then. So I understand that handing the list over to the group might be an issue that Lily's pointing out. But I don't think it should be an issue to just have the commission send out an email saying, hey, there is this group if you want to do that. You know, they're not the city, it's not us, but it is a volunteer opportunity. And then people can just choose whether they want to volunteer or not.
So send them to your website and perhaps an email also, just spell out their names. So if you'd like to investigate further,
and then it's you can give both the email address and the website. Say, look, you can look at the email. You can look at it as an opportunity.
I think it's also worth mentioning in the email, perhaps, you know, we still are a young commission, and we haven't forgotten these folks. You know.
Right. Yes. Right. I'm not really faulting us. I'm just right. Saying.
Jen had her hand up, so I really want to make sure that everyone gets a chance to speak.
Yeah, I think that. Like I get the delicacy of it. I just think that if it should be clear, like if the email does come from, it could be confusing. Like, oh, if you want to volunteer over here, you can. People are gonna be like, well, I thought I already volunteered, you know. So I think it needs to be clear that we as the tree commission were soliciting volunteers, and we don't have the capacity to, you know, follow up or whatever, however way you want to word it. And we've had a group step forward who is willing to be the clearinghouse for volunteers for their, you know, for tree planting throughout Northampton or something, you know? I mean, you have to, like, you know, get the wording right. But I think it's important that, you know, if you're asking them to sign up again, or, you know, that it's clear that, yeah, we want them, that there is a group of people who know what they're doing, and you know.
Part of my understanding is, of course,
I just have a chance.
Yeah.
Okay. So before we roll too far down the road with this potential plan, because I feel like you guys are already getting into kind of the micro with without their opportunity for other people to have other like ideas. I think that it's a missed opportunity to ask people to sign up again. Like I think you'll lose a lot of people. People get overwhelmed by email. 80% of people won't even fully read that email, and then is the assumption that those people are out. So I'm not really loving this plan of action, but I'm not sure that we have to figure this out right now. Like I feel like with a couple of people that get together with these smart people could hash out a plan that they could bring back to the group and consider. I just don't want to make sure that all of our time right now is spent thinking about this one piece instead of the other pieces we might want to consider with five to organization.
One of the things that I had been planning on offering to do was to contact people on the list and see if they were still interested. I think perhaps that would be a way of saying, did you still want to, you could send an email or call people and say, these are the jobs that are coming up. Are you still interested in get a yes or no? And kind of vet the list or?
So just a little history, is that it's been a couple of years now.
Yeah.
Or it feels like.
It's been seven months.
I guess it's been a couple of years. Not on the commission, but it's been a couple of years where it's been, there's been a long process of trying to decide who is there an organization? Who is, because the volunteer thing has been going on with me for, it's been a couple of years where it's been very ambiguous as to whether there is an organization, whether it's just raw people going around. So in that ambiguity might just be continued with that plan. Well, it would be ambiguous as to who they're volunteering to work with. And so I'm anxious to see the ambiguity resolved before we proceed, which doesn't mean we have to do it at this meeting, but it does mean that we have to think on it.
Okay, Todd and then John.
No, I agree. I think it presents an opportunity to simply say, here's the way it is. We've been, it's not false to say that the Tree Commission, through Rob, has been working to create a vehicle for the energy that is potentially generated by all those volunteers. We come up with a very clear statement, send it to those people, and say, all future volunteer coordination responsibilities for, it's going to be through, the Nats or whatever we end up calling ourselves, and just be very clear about it and make it an affirmative statement. The list is public. I have no problem not to hand it over, soon. As soon as we get that ambiguity cleared up in a strong message saying, here's the way it's going forward.
Jonathan?
Yeah, because I spent so much time in the National Ski Patrol, I think about safety a lot, and I also think about liability. And I guess, as a guy who's done a lot of work and not made a lot of money, I always think that every shop has its own rules. You can have the same thing happening, but every time you go to someplace else and they're doing the same thing, they do it differently. That's just a crazy statement that I've lived with. Every shop has its own rules. One of the things I guess I would say to my Tree Commission would be that in looking at volunteer organizations that are going to help or that are going to help you, like the three of us just did, is to look at those issues of safety. Not only the issues of, are the trees planted in a proper manner, in a safe accordance with the street design, if they get involved in other work like limbing or something like this, what are they doing? Is it safe for the tree? And then, are you also looking at, as commissioners, the economic impact that an organization like this could have on you? That is, planting a bunch of your trees, maybe not doing it right, planting a bunch of trees, having it done all right, as well as some of these other types of things. Again, as a person who's been involved in safety, I know things can go a little bit wrong when there's a misunderstanding. So I would just think that, and I guess as I would say, as I'm talking with my cohorts here, that we look at developing ourselves into an organization like a nonprofit, we didn't need to look at the liability that we incur in having volunteers work with us with tools, even hand tools, can cause certain issues. So we need to look at how that's going to work and how we can protect ourselves as well as afford our community the very best that volunteers can offer. Because volunteers can do incredible stuff. I mean, That's who does stuff.
But, yeah, we've had multiple conversations around how, whatever this volunteer group is, there needs to be a tie between that group and the commission, and most importantly, the tree ward, because of that very issue.
Yeah.
Just can't be going out, you know, willy-nilly doing stuff that all has to be coordinated. So I think that's kind of phase two, and, you know, after tackling kind of the structure of how that looks, how that relationship looks, and what your role is, you know, and how we communicate that to the volunteer.
That'd be a great thing to sit down and talk about for a bit.
I don't know if this is the right forum or time, alignment, but that sounds like important stuff, and stuff that, you know, where the citizens could possibly come and, you know, lay their shoulder.
I think it's very important to be aware of all what you just said as we actually do any work, when we actually, before we get to work.
And I would just like to circle back to your point, Susan. I am in favor of contacting our current list of volunteers that were generated through the survey and that I have built prior to all of this, when I was putting together that sample tree survey, where I brought together about 50 volunteers. My concern is the method of reaching out to them. Because when you email blast, you're just automatically shutting most people out. They're just not going to reply to an email blast in today's just age of overconsumption of email information. So if it's something where you're willing and able, or maybe with a couple of clones of you, to reach out individually to people so that they are more likely to respond, then I think that
would be something. Using phone,
that well, you don't have phone calls, phone numbers for everybody, but yeah, either that or individualized.
That would be a start. We'll chip them out and then look at the rest of the list.
Yeah. Okay, good.
I think with some tabling, just a little bit of public, public exposure. Yeah. I think the people of Northampton, I think there'll be a lot of people who want to help. And
yeah, I do too. I would just hate for us to, if we get a non-response from emails, that we infer that that person is off the list, especially if they've said, I want to contribute money or something. You know, I would never remove them from the list, ever. So that sort of thing. It's really just how we decide to execute that task.
It seems like in terms of procedure, it might be worth doing like a both ands. Like, just to cover our bases, have an email come from the commission, just so folks don't assume everything's just being passed off. So it has sort of the maybe more official, the commission has heard you, and we've taken volunteer interest and engagement seriously. And please expect a follow-up from this great group that's, you know, self-organized, and they're going to be in direct contact with you.
Well,
because
maybe
the blast and then the individual outreach might be a nice couple of
them. What would be the best way to accomplish that? I mean, we meet every other Wednesday morning. You know, could you come to our meetings and we could hammer out something?
Text for that email. And then we would reinforce it with the phone call system.
Or do you have another idea?
I mean, I could craft an email and pass it along to the commission if that feels necessary, and then forward to you.
Okay.
Just a suggestion.
I'd like to make a motion.
Okay.
I'd like to make a motion that we empower Marilyn and one other person to craft the email that we.
Chair.
Excuse me?
You're
I can't make a motion as chair. Thank you for clarifying that. Okay. What I was going to suggest, and somebody else could make a motion, is that we empower Marilyn to do that, so that we don't have to go through another open meeting to, you know, because we're coming into fall. So that Marilyn and maybe one other person who vets it can be empowered to do that, and then they can work with this group to execute that task.
So moved.
Can anyone volunteer?
Well, we need a second.
Oh.
Before we move forward.
So what we're voting on is, or seconding, is empowering Marilyn to write this thing up and
Marilyn and one other person. Marilyn drafted one other person on the commission.
How about if I drafted Rob, since you, Rob and or Jim, since you've been sort of a lot of volunteers, want to just take a look at it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So the motion, I thought we should, might include two people, but that's all right.
Okay, so let's get to the motion in a second, and then we can discuss.
I'd like to make a friendly amendment to Todd's motion, which is that Marilyn and Rob draft an email that would kind of clarify all of the issues we talked about and then share to the commission before it's sent to them, correct? Or just send it to them to resolve?
You know, the thing is, that would be in violation of open email.
Fine, they'll send the email. They'll craft the email and they'll send it, and then it'll be done.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion and a friendly amendment to the motion? No further discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Okay. Pass it in.
Well, thank you very much. We've been wrestling with how do we do this, and it feels good to have some information.
We've got a number of things to be worked out, but we'll be treenorthampton.org. It is up there, but there's wording that is draft wording we need to, before we touch on action.
Oh, the model, you have a model.
Volunteers in service of the canopy.
Wow, perfect.
And canopies will be served.
Your nerve?
We're very serious group.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you all.
You're welcome. Wait, any other further?
Thanks.
Awesome.
I think we should put that in.
You on Facebook yet?
No.
No, but Alicia can fix that.
Yeah, Alicia.
We'll get it into
things that I don't understand.
The meeting I attended when initially we were trying to, they just wanted information. I said, it was very exciting.
That's
good. I'm really, really excited. And really,
well, we are too.
Thank you. It'll make that better.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question, or are we done?
Let me see how many more minutes we have on this topic. We have about 5 more minutes.
Just in terms of mechanisms, so going forward, when we are in need of volunteer support, just because the links between, we have the cluster of the commissioners and the cluster of the volunteers with you at the helm. So like the communication mechanism I think is important. So that was one thing that we were wrestling with in terms of how do we work with all these interested folks. So is there a designated volunteer coordinator on the commission?
A liaison.
Yeah, and because when we need to communicate with you and vice versa, who's the point of contact? I'm willing to be that person, but not. But I want to see if that's even something that we feel is necessary.
That would certainly clarify things, so we know when dates are, needs are, and when we're going to be communicating and what we're going to be communicating, so that everyone informed is in our interest to get the word out clearly.
I think it'd be great to have a person, using this, it can't be the whole group, like blasting back and forth, we're pivoted from discussing as a group because of the quorum. So we don't do group response.
Yeah.
We can take things in when we can.
That's Marilyn.
Well, it might be worth kind of putting that in a box of things to think about for a later date and just trying to figure out how other nonprofits interface with their municipalities and what their models are that we can learn from.
Yeah, Molly.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think I should come to one of your Wednesday meetings.
We would love that.
We'll bring bagels.
Yeah, there were very good treats.
Here's my contact info and newsletters.
I'm happy to talk more with, was it you, Sue, about the nuts and bolts of that volunteer intake form that I drafted? Mm-hmm. If you're not familiar with Google Forms, I can run you through how that works.
And how
basically dumps all the information into a Google spreadsheet.
It's going to go into the Google
so
spreadsheet.
So then you can sort it any way you want.
Short-term plan is to use Google spreadsheet to manage our volunteer data.
Yeah.
And also probably SignUp Genius for actual date signups, things like that. So we want to have systems.
Uh-huh.
But Google spreadsheet, I think, is good. And so if that feeds right in, that would
be. Yeah. Yeah.
keep the data updated and accessible.
Right, yeah. And then, I mean, base camp, from my experience with Grove Street, Northampton, base camp is free, you know, I assume you're using the free.
You're putting all our documents.
Yeah. It just has limited, it has limited capacity. It may have grown in a couple of years since we stopped using it, but then we ended up moving to something called Salesforce, which is way, way more power. And that you apply, no, you can, it's free for nonprofits if you apply.
I have worked in Salesforce.
So if you worked in Salesforce, it can do all the things that I've just described, including signing up and so forth. So it's kind of a, you know, one-stop shopping, as opposed to piecing together all these little free things that have.
Yeah.
Which is fine maybe if your size.
Our first focus on the spring and not laying the groundwork for a large organization, but laying the groundwork first and foremost to get the trees in and take care of the young trees and the water.
All right.
Surviving.
Well, thank you again. You're welcome to stay longer if you want to just observe the meeting or whatever.
I guess we'll do.
I have another
meeting
too.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Well,
thanks again. Yeah, thanks a lot for coming.
You're most welcome.
It's been on our to-do list for a while.
Since the get-go.
Excellent. All right. The next topic on the agenda is fall inventory and planting. This is really just, I know that you already updated us a little bit, Rich. I don't know if there's any further things we need to discuss about it.
So who the vendor is, you get a contract, I'll select their contract. So you've got to select the vendor after the bids are open, and also look at a contract signed.
So that's the inventory, and then the purchase order with Amherst Nurseries, that's?
That's a contract, that's all set in stone.
So that's, that amount of money is set aside?
Yep.
And is there a term limit on that, or is it just kind of open?
The vendor cover sheet with them is good for, it's good for a year.
Okay, so it gives us a year to spend that money.
The money's been encumbered. Yep. So as long as it resides under a contract, it can be encumbered again.
So the contract can be renewed? Yes. Assuming that you go out to bid?
Yes, it just requires a change to the vendor cover sheet. But Amherst Nursery is one of those nurseries that's on the Combi's statewide contract, which made.
So they're a state vendor, right?
They are, yes, they are. So it makes our life a lot easier. Specify what trees we need, and you can just call them twice. And over $10,000, you actually have to solicit three quotes.
Does anyone have any other questions or comments about the tree inventory and the fall plant?
Sorry if I missed this. So I know that you will be selecting a vendor. Did you hope to do that by a certain date?
Well, usually the day that the bid documents open, I'll have to review it currently. And I can select a vendor that day or the following day.
Take up to 30, I think.
Well, you have the right, you can take up to as long as you like, but I don't really want to hang around too long with this because we are on a timetable. So, assuming out of the whole group of people that I read, there's probably more than one or two people, one or two companies will bid on it based upon our, what we asked for. So I'm hoping to get, basically what happens is that the contract is drawn up, the contract will be sent to whoever the vendor is, four copies. They have to put all their information in there, they have to send back four signed copies. Gets back to DPW, it's logged in, goes to the mayor, that goes to the auditor's office. They assign all the account numbers to it, and then it goes to the mayor's office for execution, and then after it's executed, it's assigned a contract. So it can be done very quickly. So getting the vendor. And then if we have, the only issue we may have is that the problem is that sometimes you always have to take a little bit, unfortunately. Sometimes you can actually take the bidder and actually, because of past experience that you've had with that vendor, if that vendor is a little bitter and they perform poorly for you, then you can actually throw them out and take the next highest. I don't know what we're going to run into in this case, because I don't have any history with any of these vendors that have any documents. I have knowledge of them, but I don't have any work history to disqualify anyone. I don't think we're going to have a problem with that.
And Todd, you had asked me to put on a future agenda discussion on the fall planting plan?
Yeah, well.
Interim plan?
Yeah, like interim guidelines related to your thoughts around, you know, monospecies on a single street. And, you know, I think, you know, we could have discussions around, do we plant on, concentrate on one side, you know, how we kind of go about this rather than the scattershot that we have.
Okay, is there anything that you want Rich to do in preparation of that? Because he's got more of the data regarding what, where there might be sites.
Yeah, I get it. I mean, really any kind of, that's a good question. I don't know, maybe I might have to communicate with Rich separately on that.
But I think if we just pick up next time we meet where we left off, I don't think that we'll have enough to work with. I think we're going to need some, like, an idea of where.
What concerns me is right now, we do not, we don't have our list done, frankly. We don't have any kind of guidelines that, you know, that we're hopefully can come out of the inventory, kind of, you know, what type of plant goes where and whatnot. And, you know, I think for the most part, we've been taking a shotgun approach. And I agree, you know, for the fall and spring plantings, I think we should kind of focus in on some stuff and possibly make some, make people really take notice that, you know, going down one side of the street, we just planted 20 trees. And, you know, so possibly around opportunities of making big impact statements of, you know, multiple tree plantings on the same street / neighborhood, I think are, you know, at least where I would want to take a look at.
I've heard that from lots of different sources too, that like that's where people really notice that we're doing our job.
Wasn't there a drive around last year or something like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we did Jay, Lily, and myself.
Me.
Yeah.
And Todd, yeah. We did a drive around. The only thing I can say is I think that the setback planning program, because of the nature of how Northampton street belts are, I think the setback planning program, in my opinion, and what Rob has been able to accomplish by getting all these setbacks, because I've received numerous emails the last month from individual residents who want trees planted, either in front of their house in the tree belt or a setback plan. And I think that with the inventory that we have that's not identified for location, or some of it is identified, Rob has that information. We should make sure that we honor all those setbacks. But when people are asking for trees, we need to honor that. And then from there, we need to decide where we can do mass planting, where we can actually have a large impact.
I actually kind of disagree. The setback planning is, don't buy a tree if you want a tree. What we're talking about is, you know, street trees on the street, in the right of way, public shade trees, not, you know, people trying to get free trees.
No, but I think
I disagree 100, you know, completely. I mean, many of the places where there is a tremendous lack of trees in Northampton, there is no tree belt. And so what you're doing is, by taking that view, you're in the neighborhoods that don't have trees. And so, and
it's true. You go between the street and the sidewalk.
Yes, there is many, many streets that don't have tree belt. And the trees that are most, like just take North Street, which is where a huge focused effort has been. All those trees, and we've planted elm trees, tulip trees, maple trees, oak trees, all up and down North Street. Well, it's either do that or have North Street not have trees, because there's no other place to put them. And so not only do you create a tree canopy, but also a huge part of the cost of these trees, as Rich is really finding out now, is watering them. And if the setback plantings have a much higher chance of the owner watering than the tree belt trees. And on top of that, the eventual maintenance, and when I plant like a tulip or an elm, I'm not like putting it up on a billboard, but the future cost of taking care of that tree through time, And a lot of homeowners are aware of this. If they can move it off into public property, they do. So it's, I think it's doing a huge favor to Northampton to have the public trees on private property. First, because they're planted, second of all, because homeowners will take care of them. So it's.
I think that's entirely right in certain neighborhoods. My concern is that if we spend all our money on that one type of tree and that one type of design element, we are shorting ourselves the ability to make big impacts in areas where, you know, there could be public changes. So I certainly get that point, but that is one street environment in a general environmental setting that is not representative of the entire city.
Maybe we should, maybe this isn't the time to do this or put on a later agenda, talk about the, like you were talking about, planting plan guidelines. Maybe we, to help make decisions, we could have a certain percentage of tree purchases go to the neighborhood planting, and a certain percentage would then go to the setbacks. Because I've ridden around with Rob, and he calls me periodically for difficult sites, and you know, a lot of the tree belts are just like really, really, really marginal. I mean, even if there is a tree belt, like on those streets by Bridge Street School, Walnut, you know, the tree belts are like
2.5 feet.
Barely, you know, and then they go like that, you know, and on the street I don't live on a very, you know, I live on a dead end street, but there is no tree belt that's plantable on my street.
Additionally, the tree belt often coincides with the phone poles, the electric poles.
Yeah.
So.
Or buried utilities.
Well, or at least the electric poles. So when it coincides with the electrical poles, it means you can only put in little trees. So this whole idea, which I really support of Lily, of having like a gate tree canopy, really can, it's hard to do in the tree belt because of the size of the tree belt, but also the pole over it. So there are some pretty nice,
Well, that's a great point. But so one solution is to plant a big shade tree well off the power lines. Because if you plant it close, it's going to get chopped in there. Right. Or plan B is to plant an appropriate tree under the power lines to give the street its walls.
Right.
Right now we're talking more about the canopy. Okay, the canopy's fine looking top down. My concentration is what's it look like on the ground as a pedestrian, driver, cyclist, whatever. And I would argue that planting whatever's an appropriate short, you know, tree directly under the power lines also has merit.
So right now, of the trees we're ready to plant this fall and spring, about half are large trees and half are under power line trees. And I've seen, read the Schmidt power, you know, Schmidt. Has a list of trees that they're developing of great variety that can go under power lines, including ones that are, they're miniaturizing trees. And so, you know, yeah, it's great.
One thought that I just had, because I agree with both of you, like I just can't see anything to argue with either of you. And so I'm wondering if we can have our cake and eat it too. I'm wondering if we can focus on size and diversity and shade in people's setback plans, and more of a unified monoculture, beautiful, like, you know, I think I grew up in D.C., like, you know, in the springtime when the Japanese cherry blossoms come, it's just like drop dead gorgeous, and it's all the same kind of tree, and that's what makes it so powerful. So I'm wondering if we can adopt this blended approach where we have our wall, and then we have our shade tree too, but we're not sort of taking our eye off either, because they're both really important. I mean, the wall is way more important, I think, for traffic calming. Mm-hmm. But in terms of like, you know, shade and maintenance and everything you just described, Rob, is important for the setback.
How many trees are we going to plant this fall?
100. Well, there are
182 available for nursery, plus we have committed trees that are still in the holding nursery that we saw in there.
Yeah.
So we have, I think, like 12 or 14 trees
left over.
Yeah, yeah. They're in the holding nursery.
But we know that some of them will be planted in the spring.
Yeah.
Not the fall. I mean,
so maximum 180. That's still learning process for what works and what doesn't work.
And it's really kind of hard to, it's It's going to be easier probably to find locations for setback lines than it is actually to find locations for shade, for actual shade trees in a tree belt, because of the issues with very limited tree belt size. And until we actually have 1,000 planting sites selected by the, through the inventory, which I think will be a really good tool and really help guide us as to, you know, where we can plant trees in the bulk right away, how many we can plant, what's the percentage versus the percentage we can plant as setback plants.
I do think that Todd's point of having that wall under the power lines, and I've been conflicted about that, because I've been like, well, okay, how many crab apples and red buds and stuff like that are people really going to put up with it? It's like, oh, you're investing in something that doesn't do this. And I'd love to see it. I mean, I'd love to see the town commit. I haven't felt that there's a commitment to that, but to planting under power lines, lots of trees.
I'm thinking about King Street, you know, there's a pretty wide tree belt there. There's, you have power lines and you have telecom lines. The power lines are at the top. So you've got, you know, probably 25, 30 feet to work with before you even get to the telecom lines. And then we get to the power lines, it's another 10 feet, potentially. So I think you could get some, you know, decent sized trees that are more than just like a crab apple, and planted in a section of the city like that. I think these are, you know, these are the things that we have time to answer. So far, the good thing is we have a plan, we have funding, we have trees. So I think it might be worth just doing a little test and seeing, you know, what we can buy and what does well before we overcommit. Because until you put it in the ground, until you put a tree in the soils, you obviously don't know like how it's going to survive in that environment. So we might have, you know, I've had trees that I'm really surprised with how well they do, right? So I've been like planting, so I planted a bunch of honey locusts downtown. I was like, can't kill them, no problem, you know? And they're doing terribly, right? But you know, my zilcovas, my sweet gums are doing great. So sometimes based upon, But based upon the soil medium and just what the site selection, oftentimes we don't know what's gonna happen until we start to just pull the trigger on planting in certain areas. And maybe not overplant, maybe just do like little streets. You're like, okay, visually, how do we like that? And I think that's a way of kind of thinking of the fact that we're looking over like, you know, 20 years of planting activities to actually start to make a difference in the overall tree canopy.
So there's a software program called Canvas. Have you heard of it?
What's it called?
Canvas, it's weird. Canvas, C-A-N-V-I-S.
Like visualize a canvas.
Yeah, I guess so.
V-I-S?
Yeah,
it's like Community Viz, right? Because like Community Viz is like a community visualizer, so I bet Canvas is like...
It's developed by NOAA.
Okay.
For climate change, sort of visualizing changes you make to the coast, like riprap. But anyway, there's this huge image library of trees and park infrastructure. It's very simple. You upload a photo of your street.
Yeah.
That you're thinking about planting, and you could plant the same tree. It could be a little, it could be a big shade tree, and you can actually see what it looks like. Some people get really good at it, make shadows.
Oh, cool.
It's an open system, so anybody can upload their...
You can, well, you download it. It's software for a PC.
Oh.
But it's a pretty small download. It's very simple. It might be the way you kind of try out
specific trees.
Yeah, you can make your own trees.
That LA shadow tree that they, it's like, it looks kind of like a hand, it's got like shadows on it.
No, they're photos have all the background taken out of. You just plop them in, you can make it bigger, you can make it smaller. But it might be a way to try out what something may look like, not just planted.
Do you know if it's applicable to iPads? Okay, well, we can further this discussion next week. I think it would be nice if we chose at least one street in the fall,
where we tried underwire, continuous underwire planting, and, you know, just experience what that, how that goes.
King Street.
Yeah, she has a car, she has a big street.
Well, there's from the bike path into town, in front of Northampton Tire, in front of Foreign Savings Bank, and that stretch. There's a good, like, 4 foot wide.
From the bike path towards town.
Towards town.
Yeah.
There is a tree belt there.
Yeah, and it's all under wires, but it's probably half a mile long. I think when it goes past, you know, Church Street, it goes past Agnes Fox Park, and then right up to, you know, so the tree belt itself kind of ends over by the North Shore Seafood, but from Florence Bank, which is, we fin up to the bike path, there's a nice tree.
Yeah, and another comparable street is the wired side of South Street.
Yep.
Which has no trees on it whatsoever, but it could accommodate small trees, and it's a speedy tree street.
And with bike lane on that side too.
So there are opportunities.
Yeah, I agree. I'm glad you brought it up.
Yeah.
I'm glad you brought it up, because it was an interesting conversation, and I think this is exactly the kinds of things you need to be thinking about. All right, on to approval of the updated group agreement. I think it's highlighted by Marilyn what changes there are.
You saw it last week.
Move to approve as amended.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.
And just for your information, Molly, when we first formed, shortly after we first formed, we were established, I had just suggested creating a group of meetings.
I remember.
Oh, were you there? Okay, yeah. So, and we agreed that we would check it after 1 year.
All right, other business not reasonably anticipated.
Sure. Can we move the time for starting back to 4:30? I mean, that would make my life a lot easier. Or discuss possibly doing that. We don't have to decide a day, but potentially.
Well, we have a few minutes. We can talk about it.
And I would like that.
Okay. So it's just becoming really difficult for you to arrive at 4 o'clock.
Yeah. I mean,
okay.
So
what about 4:15?
I don't know. It depends on when I get phone calls and stuff like that. You know.
So it would be 4:30 to 6:30. And I remember.
I have to see whether we can get
there. That's what's proposed.
Yeah.
Well,
potentially
not
proposed.
Okay. So we have suggestions to postpone to start the meeting at 4:30, not 4. Now the next question is, do we keep the 2 hour once every 2 weeks?
I don't know. Do we need 2 hours?
No, we fill it up.
Yeah.
Sometimes we don't. But most of the time we do it. I could try to be the more efficient. I don't need to pack the agenda. We could try an hour and a half meeting.
I'm in favor of extending it to if needed. And to
because open meeting, you post how long the meeting is going to be. So the public needs to know what the start time was. So, but I am wondering if we're at the point, no?
Is that right? Yeah.
Yeah, I've never encountered that in time. Because what happens if...
Only if we have a public hearing.
Yeah.
Okay.
I do want to point out that for Jay, he comes straight from work, so he may be somebody who...
Okay.
I mean, we should include him.
We don't have to decide today, it's just something.
Okay, so you would like to propose that for him. I kind of feel like we're getting our groove enough that if we did that, I'd still like to end at 6 o'clock. That would be my
4:30 to 6.
I mean, already we're meeting, you know, twice as much as the average commission.
Well, there are any other commissions left, don't speak.
the last commission.
Last commission standing.
So, not that many commissions left.
Last conservation commission. It's just something upon the future agenda, and also, can we put the next meeting date at the bottom of the agenda, just like timeline, scheduling, planning, just so we know like what the big dates are coming forward, just like a reminder.
You want just the immediate next meeting?
Yep.
Okay, is that just for the public meeting? Because we have it on our little.
Yeah, it's just that way people.
Like a courtesy?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Any other business?
I just have a suggestion for a future speaker. We haven't had anybody from the Conservation Commission, and I thought that might be nice. When I was making these calls about other tree committees and commissions, often came up that part of their volunteer work is through the Conservation Commission. Like that's the case for Lexington. So anyway, and that aside, I just thought it might be nice to just know what the Conservation Commission is up to and let them know what we're up to.
You know, on that topic, and I'm not saying no to that, although it feels to me like a more obvious next speaker we should have is from the planning board, because we definitely can, you know, cross over with planning way more than we do with Conservation Commission. Conservation Commission, like, purview is wetlands, right?
And open space.
And open space, but in, you know.
That's what they originally chartered for, was to operate as a land trust within the community. Then Wellens kind of got tagged on to the 70s.
Okay, so, but it, except for like having, helping to move the open space plan forward, what do they do with open space on that goal?
Most of the land acquisition comes through Sarah.
True.
So Sarah's done most of the land acquisition through the conservation
office. Yeah. So is that more of a conservation planner? Or the conservation commission?
It depends on what you want to accomplish. Yeah. Do you want the policy level or do you want the nuts and bolts level?
What about you,
Carol?
I thought part of our original intention for bringing in speakers was both to let folks know that we're here and we're wanting to be integrated and, you know, cooperative, not siloed, and also. You know, I'm curious, as I've always enjoyed listening to the other speakers to get more inside information as to what they're doing, and I'd love to hear directly from them.
Okay.
As part of the meeting. And there's got to be some overlap with treaties.
More on the topic of overlap, I did want to report that I did reach out to the Conway School. It cost about $7,000 to have a student team do a student project, you know, for an entire semester. I don't know if that is something that is anywhere within the scope of possibility within our budget right now or in the future, but it's something that could be a way to overcome a lot of the sort of like communication breakdowns that we've observed for the future. So. Yeah.
Good to hear your conversation.
Yep.
Thank you.
Do you still want me, though, since you introduced me to, what was the woman's name?
Kate. She's one of their elementary teachers.
Do we still want to at least have her come and?
So the funds, okay, so July 1st, new fiscal year 2017. Because they usually are planning for the next term, so why don't we look at spring, bringing in somebody from Conway School, so that way we could find out what they do, what we would like to do, and figure out whether or not it's something that we want to put in the budget. Because I don't know when you...
The budgets are submitted to the mayor's office by February 1st.
So maybe we should do it before submitting the budget to the mayor so that we can include it in the line item.
January?
17th or December 26th?
I would say probably more like, well, I don't know about much of great things for the school, but I would say it'll be the latest January.
So Molly, if you also have any, since this price tag is significant enough that we might actually want to think about, you know, are there other people that can provide this service too that we can consider? Do you want, Andrew, do you want to describe it?
Yes, so what we're thinking about is, so Ithaca and Lexington, I believe, are these really good, they're basically their tree care guys. They explain like what the rules and regulations are for, you know, caring for trees in your city and town. Educational for homeowners, educational for developers, and also educational for internal city boards. With a flow chart that kind of describes like, this is a shade tree. This is what you can and can't do it. This is how you might want to think about protecting the shade tree and also preventing, say for example, mistakes happening with somebody getting a building permit. Next thing we know, they cut down the public shade tree and just sort of creating an internal mechanism for checks and balances so that cases like that don't happen. And that it would be sort of graphically appealing and something that would be user friendly that people could easily consume.
Yeah, I mean, that would be something that you could buy for a challenge grant.
Yeah.
A huge amount of money. Yeah. So,
where do we rank? I mean, does the fact that we got a maximum grant this round in any way affect our ability to get a grant next year?
Part of the metric is whether you've gotten a grant. I can't remember if it's 5 points.
Oh, that's
a grant in the last 5 years.
Is that a good thing or a good thing?
It counts against a little bit just because, you know, we're trying to reach a lot of communities, but that wouldn't disqualify it if it was a very strong proposal. You know, it's not a large amount of money.
Especially it's something that you used around the state.
That's huge, you know.
What is it up to? The challenge grants, what is it up to?
Up to 30.
Up to
1,000 to 30,000.
And we might want to see if we can apply to the CPC for any funds too, so we can kind of bring the cost down.
Yeah, I have to see if that is CPC fundable.
Okay.
I can look into that. Really gray area.
We don't have to know the answer now.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
So there's something called the Community Preservation Act that is overseen by the Community Preservation Committee, the CPC, and they make recommendations based on grant applications on how to spend that money. It's ultimately approved by City Council, but they make the recommendations. So I actually served on it for 3 years, and so I have to, back when I served on it, I don't think this would be grant fundable, but the law has changed since. So I can certainly check in to see what that's
right. I only say that because I imagine having a local match is a good thing in the review process.
It's required.
But like having like other funds, like if it's...
It can be either cash or in kind.
But if it's like, hey, we have, you know, more than half funded, is that ever something that's like, oh, they're halfway there?
No. I mean,
it
just we need to see for the federal, because it's federal funding that gets passed through.
Okay.
You know, match dollar for dollar somehow, whether it's cash. And we've had communities that got another grant and use that as match.
Okay, you know what? This is a good broader question I can ask of Sarah Lavalle. She's the same person. She's a conservation planner, and she's also, for other part-time job at the city, she's the CPC staffer. So I'll contact her and just ask her broadly what tree-related projects could be potentially CPC fundable, and that could just be a good question to ask her as something more general, because there might be other things that we're not thinking of that right. We could be getting funding for through the CPC. All right, thank you, and thanks for coming, Molly.
Yep.
Really appreciate. If you think that sounds like a strong or a worthwhile thing for us to be working on, then we'll step up.
Yeah, I would definitely say so, especially if it's something that could be other communities. In terms of the timing, our next grant round is November 1st, and then won't be another year. So if it was, you are going to apply this year, you might be looking at 2018.
Okay. That's
good. So the deadline's November 1st.
And the pre-deadline, right? The
intent
to apply.
Yeah.
Does anybody want to work on that?
Let me, are we there yet to figure out whether we want to work on this? I feel like...
The CPA eligibility is due tomorrow.
But they do it.
But they have...
Twice a year, right? Because there is a springtime application deadline too.
Yeah, so it's...
Are we fully cooked on this concept of hiring, you know, the Conway School to...
Or an entity.
Any entity to help us create a comprehensive tree plan. I mean, that's sort of soup to nuts for anyone who's getting interfaced with public shade trees. They'll find their answers in this document.
So contractors would get...
Yeah.
Developers.
Developers, yeah.
Nobody pays attention.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you that right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, you mean the paperwork you fill out, they just...
No, we give them, they have to take, for example, trench permits. Mm-hmm. They have to take a trench permit every time they dig somewhere. It's a state law. They have to have the trench permit in the vehicle with them. It has to be signed by the applicant, by the three utility folks, and the director. They never have them. I'm not trying to put it in a wet blanket, but the reality is that the only way contractors in the city that are actually working in the public right of way are held to any standards that might actually go out there if they need them.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you give them all the documents you want, it's not going to matter.
But I thought most of this was trying to get everybody on the same page internally.
Yes, I think it would be, yes, I agree with you, that's what the original intent was. But it's going to be a document that's going to be able to be used by anyone really in a sense because it is a public document. I think the question is that right now the mayor's office is actually gathering all kinds of information from all the different departments about all their policies and procedures and trying to make one master packet to make sure they're all appropriated in one place. Mm-hmm. Because we have boards and commissions and they all have their own rules and policies, so they have an intern working, and I don't know where the intern's at for that level. That would encompass some of the things that I do as the tree warden, either through ordinance or through windowing with MGL law, because they don't enforce that. It also is drawing a bunch of stuff from the building inspector's office, but I don't know how that would play into this document. I'm not sure.
Well, we have nothing now, so it feels like this document will get us a little closer. I mean, I think that it will really be a clarifying process for us. It'll actually put our feet to the fire to really think about these big picture issues that we're sort of punting down the road.
The thing is that you're going to have to get the grants approved, that's all. We'll have to have some kind of a presentation mm-hmm. for him to actually review,
okay.
where he actually will agree to spending, at least coming up with the matching monies for the project.
But you said it would be in kind, it doesn't have to come from the government. What about all those people in the survey who said they'd be willing to make donations?
Yeah. Well, the mayor has to sign off on any application anyway, so I think that's important.
Well, this kind of relates back to the letter that we were writing to the mayor asking, that we start an internal conversation with the planning department, building department, et cetera. Because if you do the document now, it's going to be a mess. Because the process is a mess. So I think, the first stage is to get the department heads and boards talking about fixing the process and, it may be tied to this master thing about, the regulations, but I think we use that as a stepping stone to really focus in on the development, review, and permitting process, and as they relate to shade trees, and if other people want to deal with it as it relates to other things, fine, but our focus would be a laser beam on that. But really, it's the internal process that needs addressing and fixing prior to creating a handbook for how to navigate it. Because I here. If you create a handbook now, it's going to show you what a disaster it is.
Somebody wants you to dead end.
Yeah. So if I could just bring everybody up to date on where we are on that. So Todd and I have drafted a letter to the mayor. I actually debated about who I was going to send this to, and ultimately I think we want to just send it directly to the mayor, not the mayor and Wayne, or the mayor and Wayne and the village. You know, we'll start with the mayor because we need his buy-in first in this concept. And so we have just completed that draft, and I'm about to send it to you for your set of eyes, and then pull the trigger and send that. So that is what we agreed at last meeting, to, you know, to initiate the idea of having this interdepartmental conversation. And I do see Todd's point that we've got to kind of talk to people before we start proclaiming what, you know, what the rules are.
Well, I think you need the mayor's muscle to get everybody to the table. Mm-hmm. That's kind of really where the muscle is. Get everybody to the table, start to have a conversation. Side, extrapolate from each party the information that we need to put in this handbook and actually make sure that their internal mechanisms make are such that they all intertwine with the whole process and the flow chart is complete. Now, right now, it's actually working really well because the building inspector and I communicate a lot, but you know, that hasn't happened before. The same with the planning department, right? We can control the site plans now. So we're making progress to it, but it's official in certain terms because of the significant tree ordinance, but the communication that the inspector and I have about a lot of different things in regards to private trees, public trees, so it's been better, but there's not. So if Louie and I were to disappear tomorrow, you know, there's no handbook that says the new tree award and the new building inspector have to communicate on these X, Y, and Z issues. So I think you're correct about getting everyone to the table and figure out exactly what everyone's role is going to be, how we're going to make sure we set communication dialogues and processes for the future.
I guess my thought process on that is that sometimes parallel tracks are possible, right? You can have a funding deadline, which is soon, and a funding release date, which would be pretty far in the future, which would give probably a year to figure out all these sort of broader questions. And thinking sort of strategically, it's like, how do you take the information that you gather in that year and move it forward so that the momentum isn't lost? Because, you know, obviously if we apply for funding in November, we're not going to get funding in October. It would be much later that funding would be released. So anyway, it's just next summer, right? So that gives 9 months to answer these big questions. And it gives us like a deadline to get these big questions answered too, right?
So I suppose that there is a possibility that we're able to meet with all the parties, we're able to get the letter to the mayor sooner of the parties, that we could actually sometime in September or early September have a meeting and then actually put a letter of intent together, depending upon the direction. You know, the mayor may tell us that he wants to have an intern do it. He may have an intern actually take all the information all these departments and actually extrapolate it all and then get it out there and then try to assemble it that way versus paying someone to do it. You know, so I don't know. So we have the letter, the conversation.
All right. So we're gonna start with me sending this email to the mayor, seeing if he's behind even having a conversation about this. We've got until October 1st to submit the letter of intent, but more importantly, we have until November 1st to submit an application. So there's some time. Okay. All right. So that leads us to our to-do list recap.
Okay. If I missed anything, please let me know. Lily, I have you inviting the Conservation Commission to an upcoming meeting. Contacting Sarah at the CPC and emailing the mayor regarding the letter of intent by October 1st. Rich, selecting a vendor perhaps. Contract signed. Rich, Rod, reviewing the volunteer letter that I'll draft and send to you. And do Rod, do Todd and I have to fill out anything more?
No, we're
all set. Okay. And then Rob, start, Todd, rather send the letter, write and send a letter of support into our community. That's all I have.
Okay. Then I need a motion to adjourn this meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Adjourn, you know.